Psalm 2. Why do the nations conspire, and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth rise up, and the rulers band together against the Lord. The one enthroned in heaven laughs. The Lord scoffs at them. Therefore, you kings, be wise. Be warned, you rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear, and celebrate his rule with trembling. Kiss his son, or he will be angry, and your way will lead to your destruction, for his wrath can flare up in a moment. Blessed are all who take refuge in him.
We started every single message in this series by praying the Lord's Prayer together. This is something that we don't typically do, but we've been doing it in the series because we're unpacking the Lord's Prayer. And I say the Lord's Prayer, that's a force of habit. It's really our prayer that the Lord has given to us. Some people call it the disciples' prayer, so on and so forth. And so we want to pray this prayer because this is what Jesus told us to pray. So would you stand with me today as we not only pray this prayer, but we actually read scripture in prayer. And together we will say the Our Father. So while we say it, mean it from your heart. Close your eyes. Bow your head if you want to, but let's pray it together. Ready? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we also forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. And Father, as we always pray in this place, every single time we gather, help us to see Jesus. In his name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Have a seat. Have a seat. Have a seat. So we are in the phrase, forgive us our debts as we also forgive our debtors. I hear a lot of talk about how America needs to heal right now. A very contentious election season has now come to a completion, and we have seen that we are far more divided than we ever were before. Well, I don't think ever before, because there was something called the Civil War. I don't know if you know, that was a thing. That was a thing. So maybe we're a bit more divided than we realize, but it looks like we're very divided. And the media that kind of worked us up into a tither over who might get elected is now saying, okay, everybody calm down, play nice, everybody calm down, calm down. It's like, hey, you started it. Yeah. Right? That's how I feel anyway. And it's like negative, negative, negative. I mean, after a while, about all this negativity just births more negativity. Think about how we are looking to our politicians to do things that I don't think we were ever supposed to expect politicians to do. Elected officials are not supposed to heal us. Are we clear about this? They're not supposed to bring us together. You know what they're supposed to do? They're supposed to enact laws, sign laws, put policies into place to protect the vast majority of people in this country. That's what politicians are to do. They are not the healers in chief. And I think that you look at the trend of church attendance in this country, you've seen the decline of church attendance in this country. You see a lot of people say sayonara to their upbringing, their religious faith, of their childhood. They've gone away from church. They've gone and done their own thing because they were sold on the premise that church is boring and the world is fun, so let's go have that and forget this. And what we see now is a culture that has lost what church gives them. Like, church gives you a sense of community. Church gives you a sense of family. Church gives you a sense of spiritual connection with God and with other people. And now, because we've walked away from the church where we should get that, we are starting to expect that from people that we shouldn't expect it from, because politicians are terrible at being Jesus. You know who's supposed to be like Jesus? We are supposed to be like the church that bears the name of Jesus is supposed to be like Jesus. So healing does not start in Washington, D.C. or Beacon Hill in Boston, Massachusetts. Healing starts in the house of God. Healing starts here. The question is how? Healing starts when we start forgiving, when we start letting things go. You're gonna get hurt, friend. You all know this, right? If you've been alive for more than a week, you're gonna get hurt, offended, mistreated. It's just a question of what are you gonna do with the hurt? What are you gonna do when people do things that you don't want them to do to you? What are you gonna say? What are you gonna do? Are you gonna hold a grudge? Are you gonna say, I'm gonna get them back? Because all that stuff just births more of what we see out there. And Jesus said, every time you come to your Father, I want you to deal with sin. I want you to deal with forgiveness. That's how the healing begins. You're gonna get hurt, friend. I heard a story about a couple that had been married for 60 years. 60 years of marriage. When they first got married, the wife said, honey, my whole life is yours, except there's one little shoebox in the top of the closet I've put there. I don't want you to ever open it. Would you promise me you'll never open it? He said, sure, honey. 60 years of marriage goes by. Unfortunately, as you grow old, she got weaker, and then eventually she came down with a terminal disease that she could not get healed from, and so her time had come, and they had to get her affairs in order. So she said, honey, it's time to open the box. So he goes to the closet, he gets the box, he opens the box, he looks inside the box, and in the box are a pair of knitting needles, three crocheted dolls, a bunch of yarn, and $95,000. And so he brings it to his wife at her bedside and says, honey, what is this? She says, when I got married to you, my mom told me I'd have to forgive you when you did things to harm me and hurt me. And so she said, honey, when you're working out your forgiveness, it's good to have a hobby to keep your mind off things, so I want you to pick up the knitting hobby and crochet some dolls. Every time your husband hurts, you just crochet a doll. I said, honey, wow. After 60 years of marriage, three dolls, I'm touched. He said, but what about the $95,000? She said, that's the money I made selling the rest of the dolls. You're gonna get hurt, friend. A great marriage is not made up of two great people. A great marriage is made up of two terrible people who are great at forgiving. A great business is made up of great employees who know how, terrible employees who know how to forgive. A great company is made up of great forgivers. A great household is made up of a family of people who know how to let things slide. And a great church is made up of people who know how to forgive. Where does healing start? Healing starts right here. How does it happen? I got 3 points for you. How to let healing happen in your life. When Jesus says, forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors, he's teaching us about how to heal. So number one, if you're taking notes, my failures first. Everybody say those three words with me. 1, 2, 3. My failures first. When I go to God, I am not sitting here talking about all the problems that other people have caused me. I am talking about the fact that I have failed God. Forgive us our, not forgive them, not God get them. Forgive us our, my failures first. When you approach your Father, you have to deal with your stuff first. This is so counterintuitive because we are a finger-pointing generation. It's always somebody else. It's always somebody else that did it to us. I want to introduce you to two people today. And the first people are, you know, a group of people, actually not a specific person, but this first group of people I want to introduce you to, I call this first group of people, those people. Those people are terrible people. Those people don't think like us, they don't act like us, they didn't vote like us, they don't believe like us, they don't live like us. Those people are awful. The funny thing about those people is that those people are different people for other people. Like if you're a Christian, those people might be atheists, they might be non-believers, non-churchgoers. I don't know, they might be Muslims, Buddhists, They might be gay, they might be transgendered. Those people are horrible people. If you're not a Christian, those people might be these people. Those people, you know, all they do, they mess up because they mess up the world. They're a bunch of hypocrites. Those people, those Christians, those evangelicals, those people who are nothing like our people. Those people are handy to have around, aren't they? Because whenever anything goes wrong with our country, guess what? We can blame those people. 9/11, those people. Hurricane Katrina, those people. Those climate change deniers. Oh, Donald Trump got elected. Those people. Those people who voted for Donald Trump. If you're happy today, it's those people who voted for Hillary Clinton. Or maybe you're thinking, those people who didn't even vote. And now those people are protesting the results of the vote. It's true. Those stinking people. There's what's wrong with the world. There's what's wrong. They're bad. They're evil. And they're sorry excuses for people. And the most beneficial part about having those people around is that we never have to look at us. I want to introduce you to one other person. Not a group of people, actually. I want everybody to say hello to that person. For some of you, this is your deal. Pastor, you have no idea what that person did to me. That person took my innocence. That person left me when I needed them. That person swindled me out of a business deal. That person abused me, took advantage of me. I'm just starting to learn what that person did to me still to this day. Ladies and gentlemen, or they say, Pastor, you don't understand that person is why I am this person. Oh, the human propensity to blame. It's as natural as breathing. Nobody has to teach you to do this. Nobody. You have little kids, you know this. She started it! That's what I always hear. It's always them. Always them. This comes naturally. No one teaches us this. It comes from Genesis chapter 3. Three chapters into the Bible, we're already doing this. They eat the fruit. Adam and Eve eat the fruit. They realize they're naked and they're ashamed because they've broken God's word. And so they jump and hide in the bushes, and God comes and looks for them. And he says, where are you? And he says, I hid because I saw that I was naked. And God says, what did you do? Did you eat the fruit that I told you not to eat from? What does Adam say? Oh, noble Adam. Oh, man of God, Adam. What does he do? He says, the woman. And he doesn't stop there, does he? The woman you gave me. And not my idea, Lord. I was happy with the monkeys and the elephants and the giraffes. You came up with this whole idea. Two blames with one phrase. And ever since then, we've been doing the exact same thing. It just comes with being their grandkids. Cain hates Abel. And then Isaac, or Ishmael hates Isaac. Esau hates Jacob. The brothers hate Joseph. The Egyptians hate the Hebrews. And the Philistines hate the Jews. And then the Babylonians hate the Israelites. And the Assyrians hate the Babylonians. And the Persians hate the Assyrians. And the Greeks hate the Persians. And the Romans hate the Greeks. And Rome hates everybody. And Rome becomes a church. And the church becomes very hateful. And everybody hates everybody. It's like just, it goes on and on. And the church hates the Turks. And the Turks hate the Jews. And the Muslims hate the Jews. And the Christians hate the Muslims. And we get to this day and age. And communists hate the capitalists. And the East hates West. And North hates South. And conservatives hate liberals. And Republicans hate Democrats. And liberal nut jobs hate right-wing nut jobs. And everybody hates everybody. And it's always that person. At some point, it has to stop. Where does it stop? Jesus says it stops here with my people. It stops with my people. When you go to your Father, when you pray, when you come to Him, you deal with your faults and failures first. Forgive us our so natural for us. And it stops with Christ changing our hearts. Father, most people, when it comes to our sin, this is on the screen, when it comes to our sin, we are outstanding defense attorneys, but when it comes to other sins, we are judge and jury. Oh, yeah, there's a reason why. There's a reason why I did that. There's a reason why. But they have committed abominations. It's amazing how we do that. And this is the human condition. And at some point it stops, it's got to stop here. This is how we heal. So Christian maturity, for some of you, you really need to hear this. Christian maturity is not defined by sinning less. Some of you have been taught this your whole life. You think that Christian maturity is when you stop being as dirty as all those other people. And you got the Bible memorized chapter and verse. And you're a very holy person. And I have cleaned up my act. And I am a mature Christian. And I don't read that in the Bible. I just don't. I think that the most mature Christian that has ever walked on the face of the earth, not Jesus, he wasn't a Christian. He was a Jew. It was Paul. And Paul, who follows Jesus, who starts Christianity, is probably the most mature person. And I think that's because, and I think that's why God asks this man to write 1/3 of the New Testament. And, you know, and the thing is that what I see in Paul is I see a man who does not grow more holier than thou. I just don't see it. He writes 1/3 of the New Testament in 3 different books. He talks about himself, comparing himself to other people 3 times. When he's real young, he writes a book called 1 Corinthians. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, he says, I am the least of the apostles. And then he gets a little older and he writes a book called Ephesians. And in chapter 3 of Ephesians, verse 18, he says, I'm the least of the saints. And then he gets really old and he's about to die and he writes 1 Timothy. And in chapter 1 of 1 Timothy, he says, I am the worst of sinners. And you read that as a Christian today and you say, Paul, you're going backwards. You're supposed to start with worst of sinners, move up to least of the saints, move up to least of the apostles, and eventually become super apostle Paul. And Paul's saying, that's not how it works, friend. Here's how it works. As a Christian, the more you grow as a Christian, the more you become aware of just how unworthy you are to be a Christian. The closer you get to God, the more holy you realize God actually is. And so there's never boasting. There's never boasting because in the privilege of his grace, he brings us closer to him. And the more we know him, the more we realize just how unworthy we are to be close to him. And so we never boast and we never brag. What we do is we bow our knees in humble gratitude of what God has shown to us in his amazing grace. That's Christian maturity. A mature Christian is a thankful person. A mature Christian is a humbled person. A mature Christian is confident in nothing except God's grace. Forgive us our. Number 2, My sin debt paid in full. Forgive us our, what? Debts. What an interesting word to describe sin. What is a debt? A debt is something that you owe. So that means two things about sin. Sin is not something that you just do. Sin is also something that you did not do. So there's theologians call it sin of commission, sins of omission. So sins of commission is things you actually do that God does not want you to do. And the sins of omission are things that you should have done and you didn't do. And here's what we have to understand is that we are in far more debt with God than we realize. We're in far more debt. He has not gotten the faithfulness that he requires from you. He has not gotten the honor he requires from you. He's worthy of from you and me. We owe a debt that we cannot pay. And we don't think like this about sin until someone sins against us. Because as soon as somebody sins against us, then what do we say about them? Then we say, they owe me. Isn't that interesting? Why isn't it just a mistake? No, they owe me. They owe you what? An apology. Okay? Now you're talking the kind of language that Jesus used when it comes to sin in Matthew chapter 6. It's debt. We owe what we cannot pay. And what Jesus came to do is pay the debt we could not owe. We could not pay. The debt we could not pay, Jesus paid. So when it says, forgive us, we're coming to God and we're saying, God, just take care of this debt. And here's what the word forgive is. In the Greek language, it's aphemi. And it's a very interesting word because what it literally means is it means to wipe something away or to send something away or to cleanse something out of the way. And so in the Old Testament, there's a particular day in the Jewish calendar. It's called the Day of Atonement. And in the Day of Atonement, what would happen is they would bring two goats, slaughter one, and then they would take the other goat, and the high priest would put his hands on the head of the goat, and he would pronounce over the goat all the sins of the nation. And then they would take the goat, and they would walk the goat out of the camp and into the wilderness. They called it the scapegoat. That's where it comes from. And the goat would carry away the guilt of the people. When we say, God, forgive us, we're asking him to do for us what that goat symbolically did for Israel. Only that picture of that goat in ancient Israel was pointing to the final picture of Jesus, who came and bore our sins on the cross and carried our sins away into the grave and left them there when he rose on the third day. When he says, forgive us, and we're saying, wipe it away. Now listen, when I read this in the dictionary that I read about the word aphemi, forgive in Greek, it was very particularly noted in the definition, and it said this: it's very important that you understand that the idea of forgiveness is not wiping away the event of the sin. You can't wipe away an event. An event is an event. What does get wiped away is the guilt associated with the event. And why is that important? Because that is what we need. We need the guilt taken away. Why? Because guilt holds us back. Guilt holds us paused in the present. I went on like several psychological websites and read some articles and even some journals, and I saw every single time some psychologist talked about guilt, he used another word. And every single article, it was the same thing. The same word came up in every article about guilt. Here was the word, paralysis. What guilt does, it paralyzes us. It stops us in the present from moving forward because we're always tied back to our past. So there's this moment in Mark chapter 2, where Jesus is in a house and he's teaching, and the house is packed with people. Nobody can get in. So these four guys, they put their friend on a mat. He's paralyzed. And they climb to the roof of the house. They dig a hole in the roof and they lower their friend who's paralyzed in front of Jesus. It's this incredible moment. And Jesus looks at the paralyzed man and he says, son, your sins are forgiven. And everybody in the house that day was stunned. And they were stunned. They were stunned because who is this guy who can forgive sins? Only God can do that. And Jesus says, all right, you have a question about that? Here's the proof that I have the power to forgive sins. Get up and walk. Yes, yes. And the guy gets up and walks out of the house. And he shocked them into the right theology about himself. Jesus was God. But we read that story today, and we don't get shocked for that reason, because we've been so, you know, we've been raised in a Christian kind of like culture where, yes, of course, Jesus is God. We understand that. We don't have to come to terms with that. Maybe most of you don't have to come to terms with that. We get shocked because they lowered a paralyzed guy in front of you. And the first thing that you say is, your sins are forgiven. He's paralyzed. And I'm not a doctor or anything, Jesus, but I think that a paralyzed guy comes to you because he wants to be unparalyzed. Not a doctor or anything, but that's my idea. And we're shocked because of that. And what Jesus is teaching our generation is this: you're never truly able to move forward until your guilt is taken away. You're paralyzed in your past. And you know this, some of you know this, because you're still letting something that happened to you years ago define who you are today. Well, I could never do that. I could never become that. I could never become used by God. I could never go to church, because the day I go to church, the roof will cave in. Well, you're here now, and so far, so good. Paralyzed in your past. Some of you go to programs where they teach you to tell yourself for the rest of your life, that's who you are. You are your sin. You are your addiction. Not here, friend. Not here. I got no problem with you going to the program, but here, we preach the Bible. And the Bible tells me that if my sins have been taken away, I'm no longer defined by what I did wrong before God. I'm defined by what Jesus did right. I'm defined by the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And if you don't get this, you'll stay stuck in your past. You need to let the Holy Spirit change your heart, convict your mind, and tell you the truth about who you are in Christ. That if the Son sets you free, you shall be free indeed, a child of God. Holy and acceptable to a God who loves you. I have a new definition for you. If you're in Christ, I have a new definition for you. Child of God. Holy person. Saint of the Lord. Chosen generation. Royal priesthood. A peculiar people. A people called out of darkness into his marvelous light, that we should declare his praises. It's a new definition. When Jesus does this, it's finished. Forgive us our debts. Friends, listen, this is what Jesus came to do. This is what he came to do. He came to pay the debt you could not pay with God. So he didn't come to inspire us with cool teaching. As much as he does, his teaching changes the world. I understand that. He did not come just to perform miracles. And he still does, but he doesn't come to perform miracles first. And he doesn't come to just kind of inspire you to be selfless. Listen to me, young people, because you're getting hipster Jesus. You're getting hipster Jesus. The Jesus who is, you know, he's got skinny jeans and flannel shirts. You know, he's like here to help you become awesome. No. Jesus goes to the cross. Yes. When everybody tried to stop him from going to the cross, he kept going to the cross. When Peter said, no, wait, what are you talking about? We got a good thing going here. He said, get behind me, Satan. I'm going to the cross. I'm going to the cross because sin has to be paid for. Justice has to be rendered. And if you're in Christ, justice was rendered 2,000 years ago for all the things that you did wrong before God. And Jesus said on the cross, it is finished, because that means your debt was paid in full through his blood. That's what it means. That's why he came. That's why Jesus came. Get this in your heart. That's what he came for, to pay your debt. Romans 3:24, God freely and graciously declares that we are righteous. He did this through Jesus when he freed us from the, say the word, everybody. Penalty for our sins. There's a penalty for your sins. And you've got a choice. You can let Jesus pay the penalty, or you can pay it in hell. That's the choice. It's like a no-brainer, right? Forgive us our debts. If you don't let this happen in your heart, you'll never be able to forgive other people. Really, you won't, because grudges give birth to grudges. Hurts give birth to hurts. Accusations give birth to accusations. Blame gives birth to blame. This is what I talked about, and it's got to stop somewhere. Where does it stop? It stops here. It stops at the cross. It stops at the blood of Jesus. Number three, it's my turn to pass forgiveness on. So here's the phrase we don't like. Forgive us our debts. Woohoo! As we also have forgiven our debtors. Got to pass it on, friend. You can't hold it. To internalize the gospel of Jesus Christ makes you a bearer of good news for the bad people in your life. You got to let it go. You got to pass it on. So we struggle with this. We're not alone. Jesus' original 12 disciples struggled with this as well. When he's talking in Matthew chapter 18, much later, by the way, in Matthew's gospel, he's talking about forgiving people, and Peter speaks up and he says, I got a question about this forgiveness business. How many times? How many times my brother comes and he sins against me? How many times? And then Peter, you got to love Peter because he doesn't just ask questions, he answers his questions. So he said, how about seven? And that's really impressive on Peter's part, because in the day that Jesus lived, there were people called Pharisees, and the Pharisees lived by the three-strike rule. Three strikes and you're out. That's a lot of you. The three strikes and I'm never talking to them again. That's you. You know, you get there from the Pharisees. It's natural. I don't know what it is about three strikes. It's in our baseball. It's all over the place. Whatever. So Peter takes that number three, he doubles it to six, and he adds one for good measure, because he knows as a good Jew that six is the devil's number and seven is God's number. I'm just kidding. They're all God's numbers. I'm just kidding about that. But stay with me. He more than doubles the amount, and Jesus says, no, 70 times seven. And he's not saying 490. It's a euphemism for infinity. You never stop forgiving. And to deal with their shock, at Jesus' suggestion, he tells them a story, as he always did. He says, there was a man that owed a king 10,000 talents, a ridiculous amount. He goes before the king. The king says, you got to pay this off. He says, I can't. He says, just give me some more time. And everybody who heard that story in the original language would have laughed at that moment, because 10,000 talents was more money than the Roman government owned at that time. So for somebody to say, just give me some more time, was a ridiculous statement in sight of his debt. And so the king, you know, he's about to imprison him, and the guy falls on his knees and he begs and he pleads for mercy, and the king's heart goes out to this man and he releases the debt. The man walks out free and clear. And he finds a guy who owes him 50 bucks. And he chokes him and he holds him and he says, give me what you owe me. And the guy says, I can't pay. And he throws him into prison. And word spreads. And it's reported back to the king that the guy he forgave can't forgive some other guy for a fraction of the debt that he originally owed the king. The king brings him back in and he says, I forgave you everything. Why do you think it was right for you not to forgive your brother? And then he orders the man to be jailed and to be punished and to pay off until his debt was paid. And Jesus ends that parable with these frightening words. He says, so will my Father deal with each of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. And the lesson of the parable is this: no matter what you think people owe you, it's a fraction of what you owe God. And you may not like that, and you can reject that, and you can say, nah, sayonara, but your choice. You can keep records, and you can hold grudges, and you can end up a very lonely person. Or you can understand that you are far more wicked than you even realize, and God has been gracious far more than you ever deserved. And you can pass it on. What is it going to be? What's it going to be? I got three reasons for you to forgive even when you don't feel like forgiving. When you don't feel like forgiving, number one, you are never more like God than when you forgive. What is God's chief activity in heaven right now? Forgiving people. I think about the Lord's Prayer. Right there. Every time somebody prays it, forgive us. What does God do? He forgives. And I think about how many times on the face of the earth that prayer is prayed a day. And every time, God says, forgiven. 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 What's he in heaven doing right now? Forgiving. Forgiven. 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 My son paid for it. My son paid for it. My son paid for that. 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 That's what he's doing. His chief activity is forgiving. When you forgive, you're acting just like your father. And listen, if you don't forgive, you're acting nothing like your father. And some of you, you want to win people to your church and to your faith. And the worst thing that you can do is hold grudges. You understand? If you're still talking about what did you 15 years ago, and then you're trying to tell people to come to church, they're going to want nothing to do with your God. But if you're a forgiving person and you live in the freedom of his grace toward you and give grace toward others, the people you want to win to Christ will wonder where you got your freedom. You won't even have to say a word. They'll see it and they'll love it. You got to be like God. This is what it means. This is why we forgive when we don't want to forgive, because you're never more like God when you forgive. Number two, it's only reasonable for forgiven people to forgive. That's what the point of the parable is. It's only reasonable. Some of you are still under the impression, however, that you haven't offended God nearly as much as everybody else in your life has offended you. And again, that just speaks to your immaturity in Christ, that you don't realize just how much you've been forgiven. That's what it's showing. It's only reasonable once you come to know what Christ has done for you that you pass on forgiveness to others who have hurt you. And then number three, when we don't forgive, we're the ones punished for it. Yes. So that's how the parable ends. The guy who doesn't forgive the other guy gets punished. Isn't that ironic? He doesn't get punished for what he owed. He gets punished for not forgiving. And that's where some of you are right now. Because here's what we do when we don't forgive. We rehearse it. Carrying it around in your head again and again and again. Oh my gosh, I can't believe they did that. I can't believe it. It's called resentment. The word resentment, sentiment, means to think. Re means to again, means again. So here's what resentment is. It's to think about it again and again and again and again and again. And that's where some of you are. And who's hurting? You. You're in the pain. You're in the bitterness. You're in the burden of holding on to it. And God wants to release it, but you refuse to let it go. You are punished. You say, I don't like a punishing God. Listen, it's not like he's up there making it happen. It's just how he programmed it to happen. This is how it works in interpersonal relationships. It's how it happens. So it's natural to happen in our hearts that we get angry and isolationist and grumpy, and nobody wants to be around us anymore. When we don't forgive, we are punished for it. All right, so let's talk about this. Well, they didn't ask for forgiveness. Okay, well, before I answer that, before I give you the three points, first, is it a small thing? Because if it's a small thing, just forgive. And don't wait for it. Because I guarantee you, there are many small things you never specifically named to God, and he forgave you anyway. Okay, you haven't done that. I haven't done it either. I have not bullet listed all the ways, even the minute ways, in which I have not given God the honor and the obedience he needs, or he not needs, but is worthy of. So if it's small, I mean, seriously, in the grand scheme of eternity, like, you know, to be a Christian is to believe that one day you're going to die and this world is going to be gone to you and you're going to go to heaven and live there not for 50 years, but for eternity. And it's like, in light of the eternal spectrum of what you're going to enjoy forever, is that little tiny little speck in the 60 to 80 years that God gives you here, is it really that big of a deal? Just forgive. So, but listen, I know there are some of you here and you have been seriously run over by someone. And so for me to tell you, well, just forgive them and say, just go, I understand. I can't do that. And I think that would be negligent of me. So for those of you who have that serious hurt, three things for you. All from Matthew 18. Number one, talk to them. Jesus says, if your brother sins against you, go and tell, what's the word, everybody? What's the word? Him. Talk to them. You don't understand, it's going to hurt to talk to them. I don't want to go talk to them. Okay, well, what's better? Talking to them hurt or holding on to it for the next 20 years hurt? Which one do you want? You know what I'm saying? Hold your question for the end. And so you've got a choice there. Talk to them. Talk to that person. Notice that Jesus does not say, if your brother sins against you, log on to Facebook. And then you just post a passive aggressive thing there that's aimed at them. Talk to them. Number two, be specific. If they've hurt you, tell them what it is. Don't be general. Well, you upset me. Why? Well, if I tell them why, then I'll look weak. You are weak. The sooner that you come to terms with that, the better off you are, because Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. It's the weak people that get the resources that God offers, not the strong ones. So tell them exactly what it was. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault. Now listen, if your brother sins, that means you better make sure it's a sin. You better make sure what they did to you was breaking a commandment. Won't you be holding grudges because they didn't invite your little 12-year-old to their 12-year-old's birthday party? It's not a sin. You just have your own little 12-year-old birthday party and dance your face off. Tell them what it was. And then thirdly, keep trying to work it out. So they didn't listen to me. Okay, well, the Bible's not done. Jesus isn't done. The next verse, he says, if they don't listen, take one or two along with you. Take people with you who can give credence to the offense. Okay? And then he says, he goes on. It's not done yet. He says, okay, now if they don't listen to those two or three people, then you bring it to the church. Aha. That's why you need a church. That's why you need a family of believers, so that you can work this stuff out with people who will hold people accountable to what the Bible teaches. Do you understand? Some of you only come to church every single week, no matter how many times I tell you, and you never get into a small group, and then you wonder why your relationships are all jacked up. You need believers who will pray for you, love you, help you, hold you accountable, hold the people who offend you accountable. Now, okay, I get this question too. Now listen, I know some of you are saying, yeah, but they're not a Christian. Okay, I get it. But here's what I think. You gotta leave the church out of it, because there's no way they're gonna listen to the church. Don't bring me to your unsaved friend to try to resolve your issues with them. I'm not coming. If they're not a Christian though, here's what I would do. I would still follow the same procedure outside of the church issue. And even if they don't acknowledge that it was wrong, and even if they don't say, I'm sorry, I truly know and believe that God will heal your heart.
That's right.
And you're accountable to what God says. So do what he tells you to do and let the rest take care of itself. Now, some of you will say, Pastor, I would love to do all this, but they're dead. All I have to say to that is, then they got what they deserved. That was a joke, by the way. You could have laughed at that moment. It's true, though. The wages of sin is death. So let it go. And let the judge of all the earth do what is right when he raises the dead to life. So summing up this portion of the Lord's Prayer one more time. We've been rewriting this prayer all 3 weeks so far, and here's this portion of the prayer. Father, I acknowledge my failures first. And I thank you that my sin is paid in full through Christ. And I commit to pass forgiveness on. You've got a choice. In a world that is filled with noise, blaming them, blaming him or her, my question to you is, are you ready to heal? It starts here. Stand with me.